Hello friends, welcome again to my channel ELS, English Literature Studies with Core Harpreet. Today's video is about John Keats' Sensuousness in Poetry, and the meaning of sensuousness is like this. Let us start with John Keats. Time period is 1795 to 1821. John Keats was an English romantic poet. He was one of the main figures of the second generation of romantic poets, along with Lord Byron and P.B. Shelley. In 1640, this term was apparently coined by Milton to recover the original meaning of sensual and to avoid the unwanted overtones of sensual. It usually implies pleasing of the senses by art or similar means. For example, great music can be a good source of sensual delight also. But by 1870, this term came to mean alive to the pleasures of the senses. Keats said, "Oh, for life of sensations rather than that of thoughts." Sensuousness means appeal to our senses, but the term sensuousness in poetry meant poetry which is not devoted to any idea or a philosophical thought, but mainly to the task of giving delight to the senses. Sensuous poetry would have an appeal to our eyes by presenting beautiful and colorful world pictures, to our nose by arousing sense of smell, and so on. It is a quality in poetry which appeals the senses like hearing, seeing, touching, smelling, and tasting. Keats is a painter of words. In a few words, he presents a concrete and solid picture of sensuous beauty, like in these lines he said, "Her hair was long, her foot was light, and her eyes were wild." The sense of sight was specially well utilized by Keats to paint the most vivid pictures in his poems. In Autumn, he presents beautiful pictures of the seasons of mist and mellow fruitfulness. The ripeness of autumn is conveyed to us in beautiful pictures which come to our life in our mind. We see the season through the pictures of the harvester, through gleaner and the cider presser. Again, the music of the nightingale produces sweet pain in the poet's heart when he says, "The voice I heard this passing night was heard in ancient days by emperors and clowns." Keats is preeminently a poet of sensations, whose very thought is closed in sensuous images. The epithets he uses are rich in sensuous quality, like watery clearness, delicious face, melodious plot, sunburnt mirth. These are the epithets used by him in his poetry. Keats has the rare gift of presenting concrete and sensuous imagery. How vivid and enchanting is the description of wine bubbles in these lines when he says, "With beaded bubbles winking at the brim and purple-stained mouth." In delicious detail, the speaker describes the appearance of the wine. It has little bubbles at the brim of the beaker like little eyes. It also stains your mouth purple when you drink it, like any strong red wine will do. This delight in pure sensation was, however, but a passing phase with Keats. As his mind matured, his sympathies broadened. He felt at one with the human heart in sorrow. Again, he sees things not only in their beauty, but also in their truth. In his maturer performances in The Odes and in Hyperion, sensuousness is penetrated by sentiments. He was a worshipper of beauty and pursued beauty everywhere, and it was his senses that first revealed to him the beauty of things when he said, "A thing of beauty is a joy forever." The beauty of universe, from the stars of the sky to the flowers of the woods. In this way, imagination sees the principle of beauty in all things. Thus, it was his sense impression that kindled his imagination, which made him realize the great principle that beauty is truth, truth is beauty. This philosophical statement means that the real beauty of a thing lies on its permanence, and that there is only one ultimate beauty in this world is truth, which will never perish. His poetry is spontaneous overflow of his imagination kindled by the senses. He hears the songs of the nightingale and is filled with deep joy, which at once kindles his imagination. He has been hearing the actual song of nightingale, but when his imagination is excited, he hears the eternal song of the nightingale singing from the beginning of the time. He is bewitched by the beauty of Grecian urn and of figures carved upon it. His imagination is heard melodies are sweet, but those unheard are sweeter. Keats argues that the power of thought, the imagination, and anticipation is often greater than the act itself. Melodies that are imagined and anticipated are always in tune. Keats believes that imagining something brings more fulfillment and contentment than a real version ever could. He imagines such sweet melodies that he wants them to play on, not in reality to his sensual ear, but in his mind, because they are faultless and eternal, whereas in reality, they are not only imperfect, but finite also. So friends, this is my little effort on describing sensuousness in John Keats' poetry. I hope you will like my video, and if you like it, please don't forget to like, share and subscribe my channel. And if you are new on my channel, please hit the bell button so that you can get notifications for my upcoming videos. Thanks a lot for watching.